Monsieur Ireland, Madame Gordon, Professeur Lozano, Mesdames, Messieurs, il me fait grand plaisir de vous accueillir ce soir pour la présentation Donald Kahn pour 2010. As Chair of the Parkinson Society Scientific Advisory Board and Donald Kahn Lecture Selection Committee, I want to welcome you here tonight, and I want to mention how excited and happy I am to have been part of the Parkinson's Disease Alliance. Just a couple of hours ago, a number of top neuroscientists in Canada were presenting in a symposium dedicated to Parkinson's disease research. And I think that this symposium now, it's been going on for several years, serves a great purpose because it also brings other researchers in neuroscience into the realm of Parkinson's research. And I think among these, among the many talks, we had some really truly interesting contributions to research in Parkinson's disease. And of course, one of the most illustrious was our Donald Kahn lecturer, who also participated in this symposium. So it's really fitting, I think, that for the past couple of years, the Donald Kahn lecture is held in conjunction with the Parkinson's Research Alliance. I think these two events are really very appropriately joined. I also want to draw your attention to the slide where you can see the list of the past Donald Kahn lecturers. And I think the point I'm trying to make is that the Donald Kahn lecture is really the highest honor bestowed by the Parkinson Society. And I think that our lecture this year is well deserving. Dr. Lozano est un pionnier dans la stimulation cérébrale profonde. C'est vraiment un leader au niveau international dans ce domaine. Et il a amené d'énormes contributions qui ont contribué en fait à au bien-être des patients et à l'avancement dans le domaine. Dr. Lozano obtained his medical degree from the University of Ottawa and his PhD in neurobiology and neurosurgical training at McGill University. He was appointed to the Department of Surgery at the University of Toronto in 1991 and was named full professor in 1999. Il est actuellement professeur et titulaire de la chaire R.R. Tasker en neurochirurgie fonctionnelle ainsi que d'une chaire de recherche Canada niveau 1 en neurosciences. Dr. Lozano wanted me to mention that he's a neurosurgeon, not a neurologist, as mentioned on the handout that you had. And I think that's a very important distinction. So we should all be clear on that. And his CV really is attests to that. Dr. Lozano's research is really focused on developing, not just carrying out deep brain stimulation, but really innovating surgical treatment for neurological and more recently even psychiatric disorders, including Parkinson's disease. His work has appeared in over 300 peer-reviewed publications, and he's been an invited lecturer, visiting professor throughout the world. Apparently, he just got off the plane from Spain, and he was visiting, I can't even remember where before that, but he's definitely in high demand, and he's really considered one of the top in his field. He's also an editor of the textbook of Stereotactic and Functional Neurosurgery, and he's trained over 50 neurosurgical fellows and PhD students, which is really an amazing achievement. Et il a siégé au conseil d'administration et à la direction de plusieurs organismes internationaux et à titre de président des sections américaines et mondiales de la Société de Stereotactic and Functional Neurosurgery. He serves on international editorial board of 10 journals and has received a number of awards, including the Gold Medal of the Royal College of Physicians and Surgeons of Canada, the Penfield Award, the Order of Merit of Spain, the Jonas Salk Award, and has been elected a Fellow of the Royal Society of Canada. C'est avec un immense plaisir que je voudrais accueillir Dr. Andrés Lozano.
Well, thank you so much, Ted, for those very kind words, and it's a real thrill to be here, really for three reasons. First, it's a great honor to receive this lectureship, and I think I'm the seventh awardee, And when you look at the names that have received this in the past, it's really the who's who of people that really made a difference in the field of Parkinson's disease. Second, Donald Collin is a mentor and a friend, and Professor Collin has really made outstanding contributions to the field of Parkinson's disease. He was the first one to use synthetic dopamine analogs to treat Parkinson's disease as a dopamine agonist. He discovered some of the dopamine receptors in the brain, and he used PET scanning to look at the natural history and some of the causes of Parkinson's disease. So Dr. Collin is an example of how Canadians have really made an outstanding contribution to the field of Parkinson's disease. It's a real honor to receive this lectureship in his honor. And third, I grew up in Ottawa. So when my family moved from Spain, we moved to Ottawa, and I went to medical school at Ottawa, and indeed my family is here today. So it's a great pleasure to be here in Ottawa today with you. So what I'd like to do today is to go over some of the past and what have we done with surgery for Parkinson's disease, what are we working on now, and what promise does the future hold for Parkinson's disease, particularly as it applies to surgery. And as you've heard, I'm a surgeon, so that's what I do. I go to the operating room and I operate on people who have Parkinson's disease and other things like that. And, you know, Parkinson's disease is a pretty common disorder. I think most of you will recognize some of the people that are afflicted with Parkinson's disease, and it's estimated in Canada there are roughly 100,000 patients with Parkinson's disease, and it's an age-related disorder such that if you are 65 or over, your chances of having Parkinson's disease are 3%. But it can affect young people, and in fact, you can see, for example, Michael J. Fox, who got Parkinson's disease when he was in his 30s, and in fact, the youngest recorded age is age 6 for Parkinson's disease. So it can also affect very young people. And worldwide, it's estimated that there's about 4.5 million people with Parkinson's disease, and this number is probably going to triple in the next 30 years as the population ages. So we're dealing with an illness that is quite prevalent. Now, the fundamental disturbance in Parkinson's disease, at least by the time neurologists diagnose it, is that there are loss of dopamine neurons in the brain. And I don't have a good pointer, but on the slide on the left, there is a midbrain, and there's a black streak, and that's called the substantia nigra. And we are all born with about 450,000 dopamine-producing neurons in our brains. And in Parkinson's disease, it is these neurons that are particularly susceptible to be lost. And if you look at the slide on the right, you see that that black streak, that black comma shape, is just about gone. And that would represent the brain of a patient with advanced Parkinson's disease. Thank you so much. Thank you, Katerina. So that represents the brain of a patient with advanced Parkinson's disease, where these pigmented cells in the nigra are just about gone, and this would correspond to about a 95% wipeout of these neurons in the brain. So it turns out that humans are the only species that get Parkinson's disease, and you might ask, well, why is that? Well, one reason is that humans live longer than most other species, except if you're a Galapagos turtle, for example, where you tend to live longer, but so far it hasn't been reported in them. But the other reason is that I think humans have been shortchanged when it comes to dopamine neurons. So if you happen to be a mouse, your brain is tiny, it weighs 1 gram, yet you have 20,000 dopaminergic neurons in your brain. Whereas if you're a rat, you have 45,000, if you're a monkey, about 165,000, and a human who has a brain that is 1,400 times greater than a mouse only has 22 times more neurons. So I think humans have been shortchanged. I think we live longer. Our neurons have only been designed to, you know, live a few decades, and in fact, we're living longer, and we're being shortchanged in that we don't have that many neurons. And so I think this is one of the reasons why humans are unique in their propensity for developing Parkinson's disease. Now, you might say, how does losing dopamine cause the trouble that you see in Parkinson's disease? And it looks like what dopamine does, it is regulating the activity of neurons in the brain. And this is work done by a Canadian group, Filion and Tremblay, in Quebec City. Again, Canadian neurosciences leading the way. And this is an area of the brain called the globus pallidus internus. And if you're a normal monkey, then you have neurons that fire roughly at 71 times per second in this part of the brain. On the other hand, if you're given MPDP, which causes the neurons, the dopamine neurons, to die, then these neurons start firing at a much more rapid rate, and the neurons are firing at 117. So as a consequence of missing dopamine, the neurons in your brain are completely out of whack, and many of them are firing excessively. Many of them are firing at a much higher rate than they should be. So one of the problems is that in Parkinson's disease, there are neurons in the brain are too active, they're overactive. So how does this cause trouble? Well, this is a circuit diagram of the brain, and what I showed you was these neurons here in the globus pallidus, and it turns out that the globus pallidus works very much like a brake in your car. And you can imagine that if your brakes are on in an overactive or an exuberant fashion, that you would shut down the motor system. And that appears to be what happens. So when you're missing dopamine, the brakes on the motor system are on at an excessive rate, and you simply cannot move. And because these brakes are connected to other areas of transmission, you have focal disturbances in the brain that are really magnified and transmitted throughout large networks in the brain, such that you have loss of dopamine neurons, which are relatively focal disorder, causing widespread disturbances across the entire motor circuitry and across entire motor functions. So as a consequence of this, you have a dopamine deficiency causing major disruption in motor circuits and motor function, leading to disorders such as tremor, such as rigidity, such as bradykinesia or slow movements, and akinesia or the inability to initiate movements. Now, as neurosurgeons, we're interested in seeking out these misbehaving neurons, these neurons that are firing too much or firing in an abnormal way. And what we really want to do is tell them, that's enough. We want you to stop doing that, and we want you to revert to a more normal way of behavior. So in doing that, we have to seek out these misbehaving cells. And the way we do that is by mapping the brain and looking for them. And just like in real estate, the three most important things in brain surgery when it comes to Parkinson's is location, location, location. So we spend a lot of time in figuring out where to go and really finding these troublemaking neurons. And so here's an example of going through, and we operate with our patients awake. So these patients are tremendously brave in that they actually let us freeze their skin. The brain doesn't feel any pain. We're able to go anywhere in the brain. Patients don't feel anything. We're able to map out individual neurons, and they're able to reveal their secrets to us. So we go in with a little electrode, and we're able to record the activity of individual neurons. And as we travel from one site to another, we're able to stop, and we're able to see these neurons that are firing in the brain. And we're able to listen to them. We put this firing rate onto an amplifier, and we're able to see that, in fact, they fire with different patterns. And this is very much like traveling with your car through Europe. And you start, for example, in Germany, and you're driving along, and you hear the language. And then you go into Austria, and then you go from there to maybe Switzerland, and then to France. And then as you travel into Spain and Portugal, the language changes. So as we travel in the brain and we stop in these different countries, if you like, we're able to listen to these neurons. And over the course of time, we've learned to understand the languages that these neurons speak. And in so doing, once you hear a specific language, you say, aha, I must be in this country. And that's how we find our way through the brain. So we're able to localize our way by looking at these patterns of discharges in the brain. And in so doing, we're really able to, at the level of one neuron, able to tell where we are in the brain. And in so doing, the surgery is much more safe and much more precise. Turns out that when we arrive at these targets, the neurons there are behaving in a completely abnormal way. So a normal neuron, this is a neuron in the thalamus, would fire in a very irregular fashion. These neurons are firing in clusters, and in fact, these neurons are causing tremor. So you see that these neurons are firing in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times, 5 clusters per second, and this is a tremor cell. This is a cell that is firing, and every time the cell fires in this type of pattern, this abnormal behavior, it is causing tremor in the patient's hand. So our job is really to smoke out these neurons, as Bush used to say. We smoke out these neurons, and then we tell them, really, that's enough of this nonsense. It's time for you to stop that kind of abnormal behavior. We want you to stop doing that. And we can do that a number of ways. One of the ways of stopping neurons from behaving in this way is to basically annihilate them. And you can do that if you make a lesion. So you can make, for example, here's an example of making a lesion in the brain, a thalamotomy. But the other way is of putting an electrode right in the vicinity of this misbehaving neurons and using electricity to really tame them. It's like taming a wild horse and really telling them, okay, that's enough. We don't want you to do that kind of thing. We want you to behave in a more normal fashion. So we're able to place these electrodes throughout these circuits in the brain, and we're able to turn on the electricity through these electrodes. We're able to deliver electricity through these electrodes. We're able to adjust it. We're able to turn it up and down and higher and lower until we get the effect that we're interested in. And if we get something that we don't like, we turn it down or we turn it off. So let me show you an example of this. So we started doing this when I arrived in Toronto about 1992 or so. And back then, we had primitive equipment. And this was the first patient in North America to have a DBS electrode of this kind. And back then, we had to use a sort of a remote control device with an antenna. And we used to have to stimulate with the stimulation and a cable. They would wear this thing. It's sort of like a Sony Walkman. You'd wear this on your belt. And then you would tape this pad onto the receiver, and then this receiver then was directed at delivering electrical current to these electrodes in the brain. So this particular patient has Parkinson's, mostly on one side, and these electrodes are in an area of the brain called the globus pallidus. And using this sort of this transmitter, we're able to deliver electricity through this pad to this area of the brain, and you can see when we play the video what happens to this patient's Parkinson's disease as we slowly increase the current delivered into his left globus pallidus, and as we turn it on and off. And remember, this is like the first patient in North America. Play the video, please. Play the sound.
4.8.
Keep on going.
So this man has tremor, and we're slowly turning it up.
6.4, 6.7, 7.
Keep on going a little bit more.
7.5.
Keep on going a bit more. Good.
8.
So now it's at 8, and his tremor is in pretty good control there. And you see that when its stimulation's on, he can move his hand reasonably well.
Touch your nose with the tip of your finger in front. Mm-hmm. Very good. Open and close your hand. Screw light bulb. Very good.
Now we're going to take away the stimulation.
Okay, take it off now. Keep your hands in front of you.
And immediately he goes back to the way he was before.
Open and close your hand. Screw the light bulb.
Can't do it.
You can't.
Just can't do it.
Put it back on.
So the difference between shaking like this and not is related to the behavior of 25,000 neurons in the globus pallidus that are firing at tremor frequency. And when we tell these neurons to stop firing in this way, the tremor goes away. So this man was the first man in North America to receive this kind of surgery, and it was quite a novelty at the time. This is back in 1992, and in fact, this man subsequently is an avid golfer, and this man subsequently told me that he got a hole in one for the first time in his life after he had this surgery. So, I don't think the surgery had anything to do with that, but. But parenthetically, this particular gentleman likes to play golf, and he also likes to bet on the outcome of the golf game. So what he would do, and again, this is the first guy in North America, so nobody knew about this, he would go to the golf course with his stimulator turned off. And he would collect all the bets, and then he would turn it on and he would clean up. He's made a killing, this man, this particular man. And I get 10% of the proceeds. So after this sort of primitive design, then a new form of this came up, where you implanted the battery within the chest, and this is a pacemaker, very much like a cardiac pacemaker, and now you delivered current to these electrodes in the brain, and use a remote control, very much like the remote control on your television, to either turn this up or down or change the channels or surf, you know, whatever you want to do. And you're able to adjust how much current you deliver through this pacemaker device into the brain. And let me show you how that works. So here's a lady who's in her late 50s, and she has these electrodes put in another part of the brain called the subthalamic nucleus. And what I'm going to show you is what she's like when the stimulator is turned off. She's not taking any medicines, and when it's turned on. On, please. Video.
Are you able to touch my finger?
Look with the right hand side.
Okay.
I can't.
Can you try to touch my finger? That side's a little better.
That side is better, yeah.
Very good. Just turned it on.
And you can see there's a difference between when it's on and when it's off. So this particular patient we operated on in 1995, so that's been 15 years ago. These batteries last approximately 5 years, and she's actually on her third battery. And even today, as soon as we turn off the stimulator, after 15 years of 24 hours a day, 24/7 stimulation, as soon as we turn it off, the tremor comes back immediately. And as soon as we turn it on, the tremor goes off immediately. So these neurons are recalcitrant. They have maintained their bad habits. And even after 15 years of continuous stimulation, they still require this. They've not lost their appetite for electrical stimulation. So, throughout the world now, about 70,000 patients have received deep brain stimulation to treat their Parkinson's disease, and every year there is an accrual rate of approximately 10,000 new patients per year. And we've learned that this type of therapy is very good for certain aspects of Parkinson's disease, but not so good for others. So we've seen, for example, that when you have DBS surgery, it improves your quality of life. It improves your motor fluctuations. This means that you spend more time in the on phase and less time in the off phase or on with dyskinesias. It improves dyskinesias, levodopa-induced dyskinesias. It improves tremor, and I've shown you a video of that. It also improves your rigidity and akinesia, but it doesn't do so much for gait and postural disturbances. And even after the surgery, and despite levodopa, some of our patients with time start to fall and start to freeze. And it also doesn't do very much for the non-motor symptoms. So if you have depression, if you have cognitive disturbances, then neither the levodopa nor DBS surgery so far is very helpful to treat these aspects of Parkinson's disease. So where are we going now? Well, we're very interested in tackling these problems that so far are not responding. This is a huge unmet need in our patients with Parkinson's disease, these symptoms that do not respond to levodopa. And so far, despite all our efforts, we have nothing to stop or to slow down Parkinson's disease. So we are very interested in developing therapies that may have an impact on the natural history to put the brakes on, or to, in fact, reverse Parkinson's disease. It turns out that although we've emphasized dopamine, there are a lot of other things that are also in trouble in the brain, not just dopamine, but other chemicals, other neurotransmission circuits. And Dr. Lang and I wrote this paper a number of years ago. And it turns out that it's not just the dopamine that degenerates, but other neurotransmitter systems, the norepinephrine, the serotonin, and the acetylcholine. So it's not just the US dollar, but the euro and the yen are also in trouble. And when you make transactions in the brain, you need all of these currencies. We've gotten very good at treating these aspects of Parkinson's disease either with drugs or with surgery. So we can pretty much control tremor, rigidity, and the slowness of movement either with medications or with DBS surgery. But we're not very good at treating these aspects of Parkinson's disease that lie below the surface. We're not very good at treating the cognitive disorders that some of the patients develop, the depression that patients develop, the gait and the postural disturbances, the sleep difficulty, the olfactory disturbance, the autonomic disturbances, cardiovascular. Speech is a big problem. Some of our patients have difficulty speaking, and sexual dysfunction. So we've been very interested in trying to understand what are the causes of these problems, and what can you do about it? And can surgeons help? It turns out that these problems are caused because there is degeneration not only in the dopamine cells in the brain, but also in other areas of the brain. And you can stain the brain with an antibody to a molecule called synuclein. This is a molecule in Lewy bodies. And if you do these types of stains, you find out that there are a lot of areas in the brain that are affected, and they're shown in pink here. So initially, it affects the brainstem, and then it goes up, and then eventually it can affect many areas of the brain. And every time it affects one of these areas, you develop a new symptom. And this progresses in stages, so that initially it affects the lower brainstem, and then in stage three, it affects the substantia nigra, and then eventually it moves on. And indeed, by the time that Parkinson's disease is diagnosed, you've probably had it for 10 or 15 years. It's only when you start developing the tremor and rigidity that is a marker for having lost 50 to 80% of the neurons in the nigra that you develop Parkinson's disease and the neurologist is smart enough to make the diagnosis. But before that, there's been slow degeneration and neuron loss in not only in the nigra but other parts of the brain. And really, that presents both a challenge and an opportunity because we now know that if you have Parkinson's disease for 10 years before, we might be in a position to intervene and to protect those neurons and to prevent them from degenerating. When you ask a patient with Parkinson's disease, what really bothers you about your Parkinson's disease? You'd be surprised to hear what they say. It's not the tremor, it's not the rigidity, it's not the dyskinesias. Their conclusion, as Anita Schrag and Neil Quinn catalog, is the thing they found the worst is actually their depression. People with Parkinson's disease get depressed. This is a very serious problem. It is more serious than their motor problems. Their posture, they can't walk, they fall. This is a major problem. They lose their independence. If you can't stand up and walk, you lose your independence. You end up in a nursing home, you fall, you break bones. These are major problems. And cognitive impairment. These are the major drivers of burden in our patients. And we've been paying a lot of attention to the motor disturbances, to the tremor, the rigidity, and so on, and not so much to these aspects, which are really the major drivers of disease burden and disability in our patients. So we've been interested in trying to understand these problems, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about one aspect of that, and that is this problem of postural instability and walking, the walking disturbance that our patients with Parkinson's disease experience. And some time ago, about 10 years ago now, we thought, what are the areas in the brain that are responsible for walking and balance, and what goes wrong in these areas? And we postulated that perhaps this area of the brain, called the pedunculopontine nucleus, we'll just call it the PPN for now, we thought maybe this is where some of the trouble is. And we suggested that perhaps in the future, we might be able to intervene at the level of PPN to improve akinesia and gait difficulties in Parkinson's disease. Well, it took us about 7 years to summon up the courage and to get permission to operate on humans with Parkinson's disease to place electrodes in this part of the brain. So why did we go there? And I have to apologize to my sister, who's a cat lover. But essentially, it turns out that you have to go to animal experiments to figure out what are the areas in the brain that are responsible for controlling walking and posture. And what these investigators did in Russia was they said, we don't know what areas of the brain are responsible for walking and for locomotion, but we're willing to try it. So what they did was they took these cats, a cat looks something like this, and you place these electrodes in these cats, you know, a little bit everywhere in the brain, and you see, are there any spots in the brain where you can put these electrodes and stimulate and make the cats walk faster? And so they did these experiments on these cats. They, you know, they covered the brain with all these electrodes, and sure enough, they found some spots where they could stimulate in these cats and make the cats walk. And it turns out that you can measure the movement of the legs, and this is I, the current, and this is how the leg is moving, and you see that these waves are getting narrower and narrower. What they're doing is they're increasing the current delivered through these electrodes, and initially the cat is walking slowly. They increase the current, and the cat starts walking faster, and then they increase the current again, and now the cat starts to trot, to gallop, and eventually to run. So you can, in fact, dial in the speed of these cats by just turning on the electricity. And, you know, it's like a remote-controlled cat, and they can walk as fast as you want simply by turning up the current that you deliver into these cats. And they will run really fast if you turn it up way up. So where are these mysterious spots where you can do this interesting trick of making these cats run fast? And they are over here. So they put all these electrodes in. When they put the electrodes in the white areas and they turned on the electricity, nothing happened to these cats. They didn't walk or anything. But on the other hand, when they turn on the electricity in these black triangle areas, that's where they got this effect, where they got these cats to run on the treadmill. So what is this area? So this area is called the midbrain locomotor area, and it is in the area in the brainstem that controls locomotion, that controls your posture, and controls walking, and controls initiation of gait, controls how rapidly you walk. So we wondered, if this works in the cats, could it work in humans too? And could it work in humans with Parkinson's disease? So we asked permission from our hospital ethics board. We said, we have some patients who cannot walk, who are falling, and we have nothing to offer them. Will you let us put electrodes in this part of their brain where no man has been before? And will you let us turn on the electricity? And we want to see if we can make them walk. And they said, okay. So we did it. So here are the first six human beings that have these electrodes in their brain. And you can see this is the artifact of the electrode. These are MRI scans. And let me show you what this looks like. So this is a patient, this one over here, who has Parkinson's disease. And his problem is that he's falling every day. Every day he falls four times. He takes 2,300 milligrams of levodopa, and despite that, he's falling on a daily basis. I'll ask you to click, please.
I'm going to pull
you. There is some sound here.
Okay.
So this is our nurse, Yu Yan Koon, wonderful lady.
Okay, you ready?
She's our Parkinson's nurse, and she's going
to
pull up, and you know, she doesn't even have to pull up.
It's just falling. Do you normally fall on your own like this?
So this man has tremendous instability. He's just, if you just touch him, he'll tip over. And that's why he's ending up in the emergency room, breaking bones, etc., because every day he falls about four times. Can you click on this one, please? So here's after the surgery, the implanted electrode in his left pedunculopontine nucleus. And now we're going to pull on him.
Okay.
And you'll see what happens.
I'm going to pull you backwards. Make a space between your feet.
I'm going to
pull you backwards
to
try to take a step, okay?
So now he doesn't fall.
One more time.
Now I can hop on the floor like that.
Good.
So in fact, this man has not fallen in 2 years after his surgery. This man over here, I'll click on this one please, is a man with Parkinson's disease. He's off his drug and he's freezing. You can see his flexed posture. You can see tremor in his right hand. You can see his dystonic left arm. You can see he's flexed. And he's trying to turn, tremendous difficulty with turning. He's freezing. And you can see that he has postural instability as well. He's going to hang on to the wall, otherwise he's going to fall. So this is now 8 months after, on please, and he's off his drugs, and you can see that now, with stimulation in this area of the brainstem, that he is able to walk. Stop, please. Next slide, please. I got it. So we just published this in October, and what we found in six patients is that in these patients, there's a very striking improvement in the falls and in the freezing. So it looks like this may indeed, just like in the cats, how you can make the cats walk and run, we may also be able to make humans walk and run by placing electrical stimulation. And I think this underlies the importance of doing animal research to discover new therapies for our patients. And we hope now, there's been about 100 patients in the world operated with electrodes in this site. And that if this proves to be safe and effective, then this may be a new therapy for those patients with Parkinson's disease that are falling and are freezing despite all available drugs and despite all other interventions. So when you go to these places in the brain, and sometimes it's the first time that anyone's ever gone there, you have tremendous opportunities. And one of the opportunities that we can ask is, what happens to the rest of the brain when we turn on these stimulators? And this is where PET scanning comes in. So we're able to look at cerebral blood flow and what parts of the brain become activated when we turn on stimulators in this part of the brainstem. And when we do that, we find that this is the part we're stimulating right here. There's a tremendous increase in blood flow as measured by O15 water in the pedunculopontine nucleus. There's also an increase in the cerebellum. But to our surprise, this part of the brain, the thalamus, lit up like a light bulb. This part of the brain is what is responsible for consciousness. This is the part of the brain that's responsible for alertness. This is the part of the brain that's responsible for sleep. So we wondered whether there could be any effects on consciousness and sleep. And as a consequence of this finding on the PET scan by my colleague Antonio Strafella. And indeed, it turns out that sleep is an interesting thing. There's a part of sleep called REM sleep, which is rapid eye movement sleep. And this is the part of sleep where you dream. And when you wake up in a dream, it's because you woke up during a REM episode. But during the night, you go through these various stages, and REM is one of them. It turns out that different species have different amounts of REM. So if you happen to be, say, a platypus, then you have about 8 hours of REM a day. If you happen to be a human, then you have about 2 hours of REM sleep a day. But if you're a giraffe or a porpoise, then you only have 10 minutes or 30 minutes of REM a day. And it turns out that Parkinson's disease patients, in this respect, are closer to giraffes and porpoises than they are to regular humans or to platypuses, because their REM is severely impaired, this phase of sleep that's involved in dreaming. So we wondered, because when we stimulate the PPN, we're getting this tremendous effect on this part of the thalamus that regulates sleep, whether indeed there could be an effect on sleep and alertness in Parkinson's disease. And in fact, this is what we found. We found that when the DBS is off, this is sleep architecture, the four phases of sleep, and REM. This particular patient had no REM whatsoever. And then when we turn on the DBS on a different night, then you see a reintroduction of the REM sleep. So we're able to show, this is something totally unexpected, that we're able to increase REM sleep and restore normal sleep architecture in these patients. So this is associated with better sleep in our patients. And also, interestingly, the patients tell us that they're more alert. The families tell us that they're more engaged. And that's because we think that we're lighting back up this part of the brain that's involved in consciousness and vigilance and alertness. So this is a collateral effect, an unexpected, unintended consequence of stimulating this area with improving the sleep and consciousness and alertness in these patients. So we hope now that this, if this is safe and effective, that this may prove to be a new therapy for our patients. And so far we found that it improves postural instability and falls by stimulating in this area called the PPN. But, you know, walking is a very complex thing with multiple factors involved in walking. So we don't know if this is going to work for all aspects of sleep. And also, this is an area of the brainstem that no one's really mapped out. We don't really understand what is there. This is a new frontier where we really don't have a good understanding of what the neurons do and where to put these electrodes. So it's difficult, and we'll have to work on this. And we've also seen these aspects of cognitive and arousal benefits in these patients. So this is one of the things we're working on now. And how about in the future? What are we going to be working on? And I know that many of you have heard about these things, and I just want to give you a brief update on some of these various surgical alternatives and surgical options in Parkinson's disease. And so you've heard about transplantation, about a delivery of drugs directly into the brain, about using stem cells, about using gene therapy. And I think, just to summarize, I think all of these things are ongoing, but none of these things are ready for prime time. None of these things are proven to be safe and effective in humans, and so they're back to the drawing board with some of these things. And I'd like to tell you about two potentially exciting developments. One is the possibility of stimulating the spinal cord, and one is the possibility of using light to stimulate the brain to get better function in Parkinson's disease patients. So let me go through some of these. So this is a cell that's been transplanted into the striatum of a Parkinson's patient, and roughly 400 patients so far in the world have received transplants of fetal dopaminergic cells or other cells to treat their Parkinson's disease. And while there's been some great claims that this is fantastic and it works, when you do sham surgery, when you operate on people and just do a hole in their head versus operate on them, do a hole in their head and put in the cells, the two groups do exactly the same. Incredible, but so far there's no proof that the transplants are doing anything useful. Because if you merely do a hole in their head and don't tell the patients that you put in the cells, and they don't know and the doctors don't know, the two groups do exactly the same. How about if you put in some trophic factors in the brain? These are some molecules that are sort of vitamins. They invigorate the neurons, they keep them healthy, they make them grow, they keep them alive. What if you infuse these molecules in the brain with a pump? And this is done by my friend Steve Gill and published about 7 years ago now. And the way you do this is you put this pump in the chest and you put this catheter in the brain. You fill this pump through the skin and you deliver, in this case, 1 microliter per hour of this molecule into the brain. And it looks something like this, where you put the catheters in the brain and you program them to deliver this molecule. And this looked fantastic. This is the Parkinson's score. So this is before, and you see that after a year, everyone's score went down by at least 50%. Trouble is, when you infuse saline rather than the trophic factor, the results are exactly the same. When you infuse saline into the brain versus the trophic factor, you get exactly the same benefit. So another strike. This has not worked, putting in this protein into the brain. This protein has tremendous effects in animal models, in MPTP monkeys and so on. You can basically cure Parkinson's disease in an animal, in a monkey or a rat. But when you put it in a human, it does no better than putting in salt water. How about gene therapy? So this is a trial I've been involved with as well, and this involves putting in intraputamally into the putamen a virus, this in this case AAV2, with nurturin. And nurturin is a molecule similar to GDNF, and it keeps neurons alive and so on. And again, in phase one, this looked terrific. So these were patients that received this. These were 12 patients. They received this virus carrying this gene to make this protein, and the patients got better. Trouble is, and the results are not published yet, but I know the results, when you just do a burr hole in the head, just do a hole in the head, don't put in the virus, you get exactly the same results. There is no benefit that we've seen with this particular type of gene therapy. So very, very disappointing. One of the trials that is ongoing is in the circuit of Parkinson's disease, there's this nucleus called the subthalamic nucleus, which is an excitatory nucleus, and it turns out that you can change it using gene therapy, in this case, GAD, to change what this nucleus does so that it no longer drives the circuit, but rather inhibits it. And this is work done by one of my ex-fellows, Michael Kaplet. And it turns out that Michael Kaplet and his team have used this, and this is phase one, and this is the Parkinson's score. And after you put in this virus into the subthalamic nucleus, indeed, the Parkinson's score drops, which means that patients get better. So this is currently in study now in phase two. Half the patients get the gene and half the patients get saline, and we'll see which group wins in this particular study. Another approach is to use gene therapy to make more dopamine in the brain. And this is the group of Stéphane Palfi in Paris. And it is possible to put in the genes to manufacture dopamine in the brain. And in so doing, if you're a monkey with MPTP, then this is very effective. So there are now trials that are just launching of using this type of gene therapy to improve dopamine production in the brain of patients with Parkinson's disease. And we'll see whether using this approach with gene therapy will be useful in helping our patients with Parkinson's disease. I've told you about operating on the brain and so on, but what about operating on the spinal cord? And this would be quite interesting because it's much simpler to operate on the spinal cord, And if you could do a smaller operation to just place electrodes on the spinal cord and stimulate it, then that might be very interesting. And the idea here is that in the brain of patients with Parkinson's disease, there's abnormal activity in the neurons, abnormal patterns of oscillation, and maybe you could disrupt that by stimulating the spinal cord and increasing the inputs to the brain. So let me show you this mouse. And so this is a mouse that is Parkinsonian, and I'll ask you to click. And this mouse has a stimulator on their spinal cord, and you can see that without stimulation, this mouse is not moving at all. He's really frozen. But now you turn the stimulator on the spinal cord, you're stimulating the spinal cord, and there he goes. So why don't we stimulate the spinal cord in our patients with Parkinson's disease and see if that helps them move? Stop, please. And this has actually been tried. So a couple of weeks ago, April 24th, two patients in Italy were operated. They had spinal stimulators, and spinal cord stimulation failed to relieve akinesia or restore locomotion Parkinson's disease. It did not work in the humans. So here's another example where things look very interesting in animals, and then when you move to the humans, it does not translate. Our animal models are insufficient in predicting what is going to happen in humans. The latest and perhaps one of the most exciting things is the possibility of using light to stimulate the brain. And this involves shining special kinds of light into the brain and making the light open and close channels in the brain and either driving the activity of neurons or inhibiting neurons in the brain. And the way this works is you have to inject these proteins in the brain. You do this with a virus that carries these proteins. And these proteins carry channels that are light activating. These are called channel rhodopsins. And some of these channels, when the light shines, open and lit in sodium, and this would result in an activation of the neurons. And other channels open and they let in chloride. These are the halorhodopsin channels. And here, for example, is a neuron that has one of these chloride channels in. You turn on the light, and the neuron stops firing dead in its tracks. You turn off the light over here, and the neuron starts firing again. So it is possible to use light to turn on and activate neurons or to turn them off using these channel rhodopsins. So this could be applied to Parkinson's disease as well, because we could turn on the good neurons that we want to activate, and we could turn off the neurons that are causing trouble. And let me show you an example of this in a mouse. So this is a mouse that has one of these lights in their brain, and these channels that open up in response to light. And you'll see what happens to this mouse. Play, please. There's no sound on this because the mouse doesn't talk. And so here's the mouse, and he's just resting here, and he has this light cable on his head, and you'll see what happens when the light turns on. The light's on now, and he goes wild. See that? And as soon as you turn the light off, the mouse stops. So in the future, we may be able not only to deliver electricity, but we might also be able to deliver genes, or we might also be able to deliver light or any other molecules. And we envisage that perhaps we could put in a port, an entry port into the brain, and then we could deliver what is the most appropriate therapy for our particular patients. So in conclusion then, we've seen that transplantation, drug delivery, stem cells, gene therapy, these are not really ready for prime time, and it's really back to the drawing board for many of these things. So far, the best thing that we have is DBS surgery when it comes to surgery. And the advantage of this type of surgery is that it's adjustable, you can adjust how much current you deliver, and you can turn it off. So you should be no worse off because you can turn it off and really have no effects. One of the difficulties with this type of surgery is that we estimate that about 15% of patients with Parkinson's disease should have surgery, and only about 3 or 4% are getting it. So there's a tremendous difficulty with access to surgery. There's not that many centers that do this, and this is not just in Canada, but also worldwide, where there's really difficulty in getting access to this type of surgical procedure. In the future, we envisage that there will be improvements to this type of deep brain stimulation surgery, to the device. They'll be smaller, they'll be rechargeable, we'll be able to do the surgery safer, more effectively, better designs. One of the main things that we face is that we don't have a very good understanding of how this works. We don't know how delivering electrical current to the brain in these focal areas actually leads to the improvement. We don't understand what the basic changes are in the neurons that occur as a consequence of delivering this electrical stimulation. So understanding the mechanism of deep brain stimulation is an area of priority, because if we understand it, we'll be able to make it much better. The challenges that remain are really to address these non-motor and non-dopamine responsive problems. So the cognitive disturbances, the gait disturbance, the depression, these are the things that currently are not well addressed. This is a huge unmet need. This is a huge driver of disability in our patients. And if we understand what causes these, I think we'll be in a position to come up with novel therapies. And finally, I think we have to develop disease-modifying therapies. So far, we have nothing to stop or slow down Parkinson's disease, and that is really the next quantum leap in Parkinson's disease will be finding ways of putting the brakes on the disease, of stopping or slowing down the disease. And I think if we do have those therapies, then every single patient with Parkinson's disease should be on them. So in conclusion, then, I'd like to give my thanks. First of all, it's a great honor to receive this award, such a prestigious group of individuals, and I thank very much the Parkinson Society for bestowing this honor on me. I'd like to thank our patients. And some of our patients, they're the first human beings in the world that have received these experimental approaches, and I think it takes a tremendous amount of courage to go through some of these things to say, I'm going to be a guinea pig, I'm going to be the first human being that, with an electrode in their brain or a gene in their brain. So I think that there's a tremendous and indomitable spirit in our patients with Parkinson's disease. And the message for you is that I think there's real hope for the future. It's been very exciting professionally and personally, an adventure really, and really a distinct honor to work in this field. And I want to thank my colleagues, Dr. Lang, Dr. Morrow. It's a tremendous team, the nurses that work with us in taking care of these patients. And I want to especially thank my family, who's been strong supporters, and my travel companions on my various journey. And here they are, and one of our travels. Here's my wife, Marie, Alexander, Chris, and it's been a wonderful journey, and we anticipate many more. And I want to thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
From the audience, then this would be a good time.
Dr. Lozano, is there any particular age group that you approved a surgery for, or do you prefer it?
Our youngest patient with Parkinson's disease is in their 20s that we operated on, and the oldest is 91. Most of the patients that we operated on are in their 60s, and that is just the bulk of the patients. And we usually operate in the 10 to 15 year range after the disease onset. With time, we would like to move it earlier and earlier in the disease course, not to have to wait till you lose your job, till you lose your social position. There's a tremendous opportunity cost of having Parkinson's disease. Patients do not go for that promotion. They do not go, take that job, in another city because of their Parkinson's disease. So it has a tremendous impact on their social and professional lives. So we would like to move the surgery earlier and earlier, and to keep people as functionally and fully active as possible in their professional and their social and family lives.
Thank you, Dr. Lozano. That was very informative. I'm just wondering, have you ever operated on anyone both on the SDN and the PPN area?
So that's a good question. So there is a circuit that is involved in tremor and rigidity and so on, and we think the STN and the Globus Pallis is a good target for that circuit. But the circuit that's involved in posture and balance is a different circuit in the brain, a different spot. And so we envisage that it may be necessary in the future to implant patients according to their major symptom. And in some patients that have already received surgery in one spot and they develop new symptoms that reside in another area of the brain, that it may be necessary and beneficial to add a second target in the brain. So we have not yet placed electrodes in multiple targets in the brain in Parkinson's disease, but I have colleagues in Italy that have. And in fact, they have placed four electrodes at the same time, one in the right and left subthalamic nucleus and one in the right and left pedunculopontian nucleus, to treat both the tremor rigidity akinesic components and the gait and posture components simultaneously.
Your lecture both this afternoon and this evening have been fascinating and extremely exciting, I guess, for not only researchers but also for patients with Parkinson's. My question is, do you envision being able to treat patients with surgery and a combination of surgery with drugs? Or do you always, do your patients have to come off the drugs before you do the surgeries?
Good question. So we only, if you are doing fine with your medications, then you do not need to see me. You know, you're better off not to be operated. But if you reach the level where, despite all the best efforts and despite all the medications, you are not living the kind of function that you want, then it's reasonable to consider surgery. Our main objective is not to stop the drugs, but indeed, many of the patients are able to reduce their drugs after the surgery. So we really see this as a combination. One of the difficulties we've dealt with is that some of the patients have reduced their drugs tremendously after the surgery, and then they start to develop side effects related to drug reduction. So they start developing apathy, they start developing a bit of depression, and that's because although they no longer need the drugs to treat their motor symptoms, their frontal lobes also need dopamine. And when you withdraw the levodopa, then there's a dopamine deficiency in the frontal lobes. These are the areas involved in executive function and motivation. So it's a double-edged sword. But our view is to really use the surgery in conjunction with the drugs. Having said that, too, though, we have some patients that we specifically operate on to get them off the drugs. So as you know, there's a number of disorders called the dopamine dysregulation disorders or the impulse control disorders. Some patients develop pathological gambling, pathological eating, sexual dysfunction, or in women, pathological shopping. It's interesting how men and women differ sometimes in these things. And we specifically operate on them so that they are able to reduce their drugs and these behaviors go away. And so in some cases, we're specifically operating on patients so that they may be able to reduce these drugs and these behavioral disturbances can come back in line.
Doctor, in terms of organ donation, is it useful to have Parkinson's brains donated?
Absolutely. So I tell my patients that when they are finished with their brains, I would like to have it. And this is very important because we need to understand each patient has a very different clinical picture. Why is it that some patients get tremor? Why is it that some patients can't walk? Why is it that some patients get dementia? So we don't have a very good understanding of what correlates. What are the areas of the brain that are damaged, where the damage is, and produce these symptoms? So it is essential for us as clinicians and researchers to collect brain to understand what goes wrong in the brains and also to understand where are some of the molecules that are important, we think, in Parkinson's disease. So Dr. Fahn, for example, works on parkin, and he wants to know where the parkin is and what goes wrong in the brain in patients with Parkinson's. Dr. Schlossmacher was telling us today about other molecules that he's working on. So it's important for us to map out what is happening to the expression of these molecules in the brain. So probably the greatest gift that you can give is when you're no longer using it is to donate the brain.
Maybe one more question.
Yes, this might be a little bit of a convoluted question, but recently in the news there were a lot of articles on a doctor who was working on improving the blood circulation to the brain with MS patients.
Yes.
And I just wondered, would there be any connection to Parkinson's in the same way? Because there seems to be, I've come across quite a few in our support groups and so on, TIA patients or yes. Cardiovascular patients who've had a lot of strokes and has affected their brains and then can consequently have got Parkinson's. And do you feel that that could possibly be connected?
No, that is a very good question. So it turns out that there is vascular Parkinsonism. It tends to predominantly affect the legs and walking. And it is thought to be caused by an accumulation of small strokes that are basically knocking out the circuits that are responsible for initiating, generating movements. And so, in fact, the more strokes that you have, the more damage there is in the motor circuitry and the less likely you are to benefit. One of the features of Parkinsonism caused by strokes is that it does not respond to levodopa. So most patients with regular Parkinson's disease will take a dose of levodopa at least early on in their illness and have a tremendous benefit. And in fact, when you're first diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, you have a 5 or 10 year honeymoon where you respond very well to levodopa. It's only afterwards that you run into problems. But in these patients that have vascular Parkinsonism, the levodopa does not do much, and that's because the circuit is damaged. So there is an interest in controlling your blood pressure and reducing the incidence of stroke in Parkinson's disease as well. In this case of MS, it involves venous, so the venous phase and opening up the venous channels. So there's no evidence at all that there's any venous disturbance in Parkinson's disease at this stage. But avoiding, you know, having a good diet, exercising, these are important attributes that you can do to try to protect yourself from Parkinson's disease. Incidentally, drinking coffee seems to have a protective effect, and believe it or not, smoking also seems to have a protective effect. But the adverse effects of those things, you know, you have to weigh the pros and cons of those things.
So I want to... I want to thank Dr. Lozano for a wonderful lecture, really showing us the scope of his work and really for providing hope for some of you out there with Parkinson's disease. And I want to present him with the award for the Donald Kahn Lecture for 2010.
Good evening. My name's Joyce Gordon, and I'm CEO of Parkinson's Society Canada. And thank you for coming. Dr. Lozano, thank you for that wonderful presentation. I got to hear most of it twice, so I'm going to learn even more from the second time round. So thank you. Very inspiring. It's wonderful when you hear what the art and science of possibility and hope is. It's really for people with Parkinson's and for all of us who work in Parkinson's, to see a cure tomorrow and the possibility of having the best quality of life, you couldn't ask for more. So thank you so much. You really presented that very well. We very much appreciate it. And I get the opportunity to present something very special to you in a moment, but you mentioned your family was here, and I have to tell you, I've been with Parkinson's 5 years, and I've never had a family come with the person who's won the award. And it's delightful to see them, and I don't know if you've met them, but I just want to tell you who they are. I remember I met your names very quickly, but I'm going to ask them to stand up, but I'm going to tell you who they are as a group. There's Dr. Lozano's mom and his two sons and his brother and his sister. Please stand up. And And, of course, I cannot forget his wife. She is a neurologist. I can't imagine having a neurosurgeon and a neurologist in the same house, but you do, Dr. Marie Slager. And we're delighted to have a family here. You can see how strong family is to you, and the fact that they're here is really a wonderful tribute to you. And you must be very proud of your son, dad, brother, you know, it's wonderful. So thank you for coming. Earlier today we had the Parkinson's Research Alliance meeting, and it's third year of coming together. Parkinson Society Canada has funded the Parkinson Research Alliance because we believe in the value of bringing people together to talk about their art and their science, but more importantly, sharing what they've learned. And a lot of times it's cross disease. So we learn a lot about Huntington's, we learn a lot about ALS, we learn a lot about Parkinson's and many other neurological conditions. And this group is actually leading the way to develop clinical guidelines for Parkinson's. And some of them are in Dallas today. Dr. Grimes in particular is not here because he's leading a group there, of which we're working together to publish the first Canadian clinical guidelines in Parkinson's. So we'll look forward to that coming, hopefully end of this year. And the other thing I did want to say is that this group has not only learned a lot together, but really increased the profile of Parkinson's within the neuroscience community, and we're very appreciative. And today there were six presentations, and you're going to meet some of those people that are here. But before I start that, I just like all the researchers that are in the room, because there are some people who came over here who wanted to be at this presentation, and you might want to know that some people here did presentations, moderated presentations today. Some of them you're going to see in a few minutes. If they would stand up so you can see them, and you might want to talk to some of them when we're finished. So there's a few of them that are here. Those that are here, if you would stand up, that would be great. Thank you. Now, I have the privilege, Dr. Lozano, the award was one part of it, but you are now going to join an esteemed team. Now, you know Team Canada at the Olympics was something to behold, especially in hockey, but we also have a team that's called Team Parkinson's, and there are only a few people in Canada that get to wear this wonderful lab coat with Team Parkinson's, and you know, you talked about compulsive shopping. Well, we've done the shopping for you, and you're going to have to try this on, and we hope that it fits. So I'm going to ask you to come up, and you are now inducted into the Team Parkinson's Hall of Fame. So congratulations. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
There you go, and we'll get you to model that for us in a moment, but you're going to have a few other people join you. So those people that were part, you have to undo the buttons. Can you manage that? Just pretend it's surgery.
I usually get someone to dress me in the operating room.
Oh, okay. Well, would you like me to? Oh, I won't go there. All right. All right. So so I'd like to call up also some of the people that were presenting today. And I have to tell you, I heard most of the presentations, and they were really, really excellent. And I just get really inspired when I hear the kind of work and people that are basically on the cusp of discovery and very excited about their work. Good job. These people, I'm going to ask them to come up because we have lab coats for you too. So you now have the opportunity to be part of this Hall of Fame of Parkinson's Society Canada. So first of all, Dr. Michael Schlachtmacher. There you go.
Thank you very
Congratulations.
Much. May I say one thing?
Absolutely.
I was just asking Joyce what I could say a few words. I have two people in my laboratory who won a coat, and I was envious of that gift all the time. So thank you very much.
All right, you're welcome. Dr. Ted Fawn, who you've heard about earlier. Ted, there you go. Dr. Ian McKenzie. Mark Germain. Dr. Isabella Hershey. and Katrina Vanderova. So this is your 2010 Team Parkinson's. Congratulations, well done, and thank you so much for your volunteer commitment and your passion for the field. We very much appreciate it, and really, I know you'll wear them with great pride. So on behalf of all of us, congratulations and thank you. Thank you. I think she's gonna get a picture of the group. We're gonna do some pictures afterwards as well. I do wanna say that, if you just hold on for a minute here, that we have our sponsor, RX&D, and I really want to thank Bruce Good. You've met Bruce earlier. Bruce, thank you so much. This is our foray into working with RX&D, and we thank you very much for your confidence in our organization. I do want to thank all of you for coming. Their people will be here. You can find them now. They're in lab coats, so you'll know where they are. We did that on purpose, so you can pick them out of the crowd. And I also want to thank some of our executive leadership team who are here from across Canada. The CEOs are meeting for the next 2 days. And we know for all of you that are here, we thank you for taking the time to come on this beautiful day. Thank you to Denise and Parkinson Society Ottawa for the great work that you and your staff have done. As always, great job. I know they're back there. And also to the national staff. It took a team to put this together. So Team Parkinson's, we're all in it together. So congratulations and thank you and best wishes. And then we're going to do some photos, and there are people that you can talk to ask questions if you like. Thank you for coming.